She cleans the lump on his head, puts some ointment on it, and tells him to keep that dry too. The final thing she does is to give Lucas a tetanus shot. "You're going to be okay," she says as she leaves. "Thank you," he says. Then he stares at his hand. Already, the cut is itching beneath the bandage, making him think it's only a matter of time before he tears both that and his stitches open. Chapter 22. I pour water onto my shirt and use it to wipe blood from my face as I drive. It's a struggle to focus on the road as the headache rages on, and Hutch probably wasn't wrong when she said I shouldn't be driving. The roadblock covers both lanes with a dozen cars waiting to be cleared. I skip the queue and acknowledge the deputies on the way past at the same time the dogs are being brought through. It's getting dark quickly now. Without any street lighting out here, the highway will soon be pitch black. I pop the glove compartment and rummage around for a box of painkillers. They expired years ago, but what's the worst that can happen? Maybe I'll get superpowers. I swallow a couple with the hope it won't be long before the headache loses its bite. I look at the wound in the rearview mirror. It's a hell of a lump, but it won't need stitches. In a few days, the lump will be down, and in a week, it'll be like it never happened. I pass the turn-off to the new sawmill. Its proximity to the old sawmill means it will be searched. I pass the turn-off to the hiking tracks, the parking lot out of sight from the highway. But this time of the year, there'll be a handful of cars in there. Folks scattered across the trails, hiking and camping and fishing and being warned by search and rescue about Grove.